So about 6 months ago, I was having lunch at the hospital, which I actually rarely miss lunch. And I got this text message from my wife. It's unusual for her to text me at work, so I was immediately alarmed. And with a bit of apprehension, I looked at my phone. And it read, "This guy is amazing. I am inspired." I was immediately concerned. I texted back, "Where are you?" And I was reminded, now it's important to know I did not forget, but I was reminded that my wife was at a day-long conference with Dr. Bessel van der Kolk, a legendary figure in the mental health field. Dr. van der Kolk has taught and inspired a generation of mental health clinicians through his work in the study of psychological trauma. Years ago, he helped us understand that the experience of trauma in ways that we had not previously imagined. He taught us through his research that psychological trauma did in fact change the brain. For many of us, his work has been the sound of the cavalry coming as we've worked to understand the experience of individuals in psychological pain. His research and resulting new 2014 book, The Body Keeps Score, Brain, Mind, and Body, takes an important next step. In it, Dr. van der Kolk talks about how to actually treat an individual who has experienced a trauma. Building on what we now know about how traumatic stress rearranges the brain's wiring, he teaches us how these areas of the brain can be reactivated through innovative treatments, including neurofeedback, mindfulness, play, yoga, and other therapies. Dr. Bessel van der Kolk has been the medical director of the Trauma Center in Boston for the past 30 years. He's a professor of psychiatry at the Boston University Medical School and serves as the director of the National Center for Child Stress Traumatic Network and is the past president of the International Society for Traumatic Stress Studies. Though he identifies himself primarily as a clinician, Dr. van der Kolk has published well over 100 peer-reviewed articles on various aspects of trauma, including projects on yoga for treating PTSD, which is funded by the National Institutes of Health, the use of theater in violence prevention in the Boston Public Schools, understanding the mechanisms of eye movement desensitivity and reprocessing, which is EMDR, and sensory integration and the use of neurofeedback in trauma. Dr. van der Kolk has also participated in the first neuroimaging study of PTSD, in the first study to link borderline personality disorder with childhood trauma, and was a co-principal investigator of the DSM-IV field trial for PTSD. He is chair of the national work group for the DSM-5, which focuses on developmental trauma disorder, and has taught at universities and hospitals around the world. It is an honor to welcome Dr. van der Kolk to Walden for today's final presentation.
Thank you. I always get very tired hearing introductions. It's like, what has this guy done with his life? But I've lived for a long time, so if you live long enough, you can do all this stuff. This is my book, if you're interested in what I'm talking about, $13. We started with trauma, but as time went on, the picture became different, and the picture became more complicated. And the picture became more and more that we are completely wired to be together. We are interpersonal creatures, we have interpersonal brains. Nobody lives by himself, nobody grows by himself, and that trauma, by and large, occurs in the context of relationships. And those have very important part, role to play in the very profound challenges that you all and we deal with. And the way I'd like to start is to show you a videotape from the lab of my friend Ed Tronick, who runs the child development program, first at Harvard, now at UMass Boston, to illustrate the nature of interpersonal neurobiology. So I'm going to show you a very simple tape of a lovely mom and her two-year-old boy playing with each other. And at some point, she has a bug in her ear, and people say, now freeze your face. At the moment that she freezes her face, this boy is going to have a reaction. You, unless you are completely heartless yourself, will also have a reaction. And it's that reaction that you have that I'd like you to really pay attention to, how your body reacts to what you see on the screen.
Here's your juice. Here you go. Oh, the dinosaur is going to drink the juice? Good. Oh no, is the alligator going to eat the dinosaur? Help! Oh, you give the dinosaur a kiss.
So that's a typical, not mother-child talk. This is how adults talk also. So John Rady and I are really good friends, so we're talking about getting together for dinner. And we thought about getting together for dinner tonight, but he's a Patriots fan. I couldn't care less about the Patriots. I don't know why anybody would care about the Patriots. There are a bunch of guys running around causing questions to each other, but this guy goes crazy watching those guys. We don't want to be in the same room when he's going crazy about some guys hurting each other, and I'm not, you know? And so, not good companionship. So if you're both interested in the alligators or giraffes or the Republican Party or whatever, and you have a common thing and interest, it doesn't matter what you're interested in, as long as you get excited about the same topic. And so this, just good, two for kids, two for adults. And now she has been told to freeze her face.
Nice.
He says, Mommy, it's me. And Mom looks really pretty freaked out. Can you see that? Agitation is, he feels in your body. It's like the agitation you feel in your body right now also.
Very
parallel.
The alligator. What did the alligator do? Oh, give him a kiss. Mwah. What can we make? Oh, you want to play basketball? Okay.
Nothing happened. You hope it's the worst thing that ever happens to this little boy. Just another day. About 6 months later, he comes back to the lab. He's a big little cannula in his arm. They measure his stress hormones. We when he walks into this room, his stress hormones go up. So there's something in the registration of in his brain, way below memory, that says, this is not such a cool place. But he has no, he cannot tell you a story that his mom didn't respond to him a long time ago. But the paradigm here is that if this becomes your chronic experience, if you try to play, if you try to be seen, if you try to have people respond to you, and nobody responds to you, your brain and your stress hormone system goes haywire. And that is something we have learned, and something that has come very little into the public knowledge. And surprising, because two of the greatest scholars in this area are right here in Boston, one of whom is Marty Teicher, who I work closely with, who has looked at all the different brain changes that result from various forms of neglect, abandonment, not having been seen. And the other one is Carlin Lyers Ruth, who runs the attachment laboratory at Cambridge Hospital, who has shown very eloquently over the past 30 years that if you do not get seen, if you do not get known, if as a little kid you're supposed to take care of your mom instead of the other way around, this causes profound biological, psychological, and epigenetic changes. And this is the area that you guys are probably working in. I'll give you some evidence for that. So again, from Edtronics Lab. Here's a mom playing with a little 2-month-old baby, and this little baby has the time of his life because he pulls on the red hair of this mom, and she is screaming, and he thinks, I'm an amazing two months old because I can make these great sounds and screams and somebody pulling against my hand. I'm an astounding kid. Mom starts off thinking he's an astounding kid also, but the kid can feel good because he has no frontal lobe. And as long as you don't have a frontal lobe, you don't know what other people are feeling. The moment you get a frontal lobe, you get all messed up because you have to worry about what other people are thinking about you. Mom starts off having big frontal lobe, wanting to take care of her baby, but as the pain increases, her frontal lobe goes offline. A very important issue, because we like to project that on our patients and say, my patient has a temper, my patient loses it. We all lose it. We all have said mean, nasty, horrible things to people we love, because that's part of the nature of being a human mammal. And that if you get upset about something, your frontal lobe disappears and your limbic system takes over. Your limbic system is where our job is. It's the primitive part of your brain that detects danger and makes you act in silly, outrageous, shameful ways. And afterwards, you use your frontal lobe to excuse yourself and to say it is all your fault. But the frontal lobe has virtually no pathways into the limbic system. And I wish that our profession would finally get that. You cannot talk people into understanding their irrational beliefs and change their minds. You cannot talk people into not being in love with the wrong guy, because they are. These things come from other parts of the brain, and unless we start really getting into understanding that, we start doing the same old therapies that don't work. So this kid is just having a grand old time, and then what happens is what happens with every person who ever has had a baby: a struggle for existence ensues. Which is always won by parents. Everybody who ever has baby has that, these struggles with their kids. You always win, thank goodness, otherwise you'd be dead. And now mom wins, and this little kid sees this angry face of his mom. In the back of his brain, he has this little area called the amygdala, the threat detector, the smoke detector of his brain. That's already online at 2 months. And he says, oh my God, something bad is happening here. So what does he do, like most people who see bad things? He hides his head in the sand. Mom feels separated from the kid, misses the kid, and starts speaking the universal language that when you travel around the world, you hear it everywhere, and that language goes, doo-doo, da-da, my little baby, coochie-coochie-coochie. And that happens in Swahili and in Chinese and in Russian and everything else. So it's a language of singing to each other. Very important. Because singing to each other is not a part of what most of you do in your clinical practice, but we have an active singing program at the Eating Disorders Program in Utah that we consulted. And so mom starts singing and moving with this kid, and slowly the kid looks to see if the coast is clear. He sees a kind face, and they get reunited in pleasure. This is how the brain grows. It grows through disruptions and repair, disruption and repair. And the long range, this kid gets an image of himself in the world, a map of the brain over here somewhere in the back where you have no language and consciousness, that tells me that if I become distressed, sooner or later, things are going to be okay. And bad things come to an end. And I can count on that person over there and later on to other people or myself that I'm going to be okay. The big thing is that if you don't have these experiences, that you can count on people and don't have a map in the world that people will come to your rescue, you will have to learn to do it yourself. And that is what I think we're all dealing with. Let's say, it's a long story, but let me make it very, very brief. It goes back to Darwin. And that's the notion that Darwin says in his 1870 book, Emotional Expressions of Animal Man. He says, emotions are lived out in heartbreak and gut-wrenching feeling. And he starts spelling out the neuronal pathways that make you register awful feelings in your stomach and your heart. And when I read it, I go like, yep, I know about it. I bet most people in this room know about it. When somebody dumps you or you hear that somebody dies, you get this heartbreaking or gut-wrenching feeling. And then Darwin points something out that has never really made it into our field. He says there's reciprocal interactions between the body and the brain. In fact, today we know that 80% of the fibers of this nerve that connects the body and the brain are efferent fibers. So you can actually change the way that your body, your brain feels, your emotions are, by moving your body. It's interesting that every culture in the world, except for cultures derived from Northern Europe, know that. You go to China, and everybody goes like that in the morning. You go to India, and people sit like this, or have these strange poses. You go to Africa, people are dancing and singing. Europeans, and again, I look around this room, and again, I find a strikingly non-diverse group, which is common for our profession, very strangely. Most of our ancestors come from Europe. The answer to bad emotions in Europe is take a swig. It's the only recourse that we have. And so we live in a culture that's derived from the culture, take a swig. Do you feel bad? Take something into your mouth and make your feelings go away. And we don't teach people, and I doubt whether you really teach the people you work with, that you actually have very powerful innate mechanisms to make yourself feel better, as explored by yoga, qigong, martial arts, jujitsu, et cetera, because it's not our culture. And we call it strange, alternative. Sadly, because we're the dominant culture in the world, they are beginning to think about their methods also as strange and alternative, even though those methods are extraordinarily helpful to really get ownership of your own body. And drugs are not. And they may be the only way you can get ownership over your body. So we start this trauma investigation. And many years ago, Judy Herman and I get together, and we want to look at Cambridge Hospital about to what degree people who are called borderline personality disorder have a childhood history of trauma. And so Judy and I spent a lot of time creating a traumatic antecedents questionnaire that to this day I'd like to invite people to use. It's on the Trauma Center website. Because asking people, were you molested as a child? Did your dad beat you, or other stuff? Usually leads to negative answers because everybody feels way too ashamed to ever tell a complete stranger who may make bad use of the information. And so most people will lie about that information, consciously or unconsciously. So how do you get there? So what we decided is to ask people, where do you live? Who lives with you? Who does the shopping? Who cooks the meals? How often is the television on in your house? Do people wake up in the morning and talk to each other, or do you blast televisions, radios? very important information that most mental health professionals don't collect. Very relevant at the end for how people take care of themselves. Then we ask, who does the shopping, who does the cleaning, who takes you to the doctor, who do you talk to when you feel bad? And most people don't have much trouble telling you this story. But you set up a certain rapport. And then you ask people, how about when you were a kid? Who did the cooking? Who did the cleaning? Who cooked the meals? Who got you off to school? Very interesting questions, actually, when you think about it in your own life. And then we ask the killer questions. Did anybody think you were a special person? Did anybody recognize who you were? And then the killer question, was there anyone you felt safe with growing up? 1/3 of the patients at the outpatient department of Cambridge Hospital said, I didn't feel safe with anybody growing up. This question still doesn't get asked. For DSM-5 field trials, and if you read my book, which I hope you will never, you'll burn your DSM because it's such a terrible instrument. And in fact, when your diagnostic instrument is more insane than your patients, it's really time to do new things. The field trial for DSM-5 asked two questions about people's background for these fictitious diagnoses. One was, can we generally assume that people were pretty nice to you growing up? And the other one was, were there any alcoholics or drug addicts in your family? Nothing about, did anybody go to war? Were you put in a foster home? The 2.3 million kids in America whose parents are in jail right now and who are being raised by other people. I mean, the horrendous things that happen to kids that I can talk about for hours because we do this for a living. Do not get talked about. And we keep talking about these things as if they occur without any context to the environment. And this is if the brain grows, not as a function of our interactions with people, but because of some mysterious genetic issues for which there is absolutely no evidence. Then we ask people, so who made the rules and enforced the discipline at home? Good question to ask about yourself, ask anybody you know. What were the rules like in your family? How were the kids disciplined at home? Scolding, withholding privilege, spanking, verbal abuse, hitting it with objects. And how did your parents solve their disagreements? Very interesting questions. How do you solve your disagreements with your partner? And once you start talking about that degree of detail, people tell you a lot of stuff. And by this time, we get our physical and sexual abuse histories automatically. We weigh it. And we published a series of articles in the American Journal of Psychiatry showing that 87% of all people diagnosed with borderline personality disorder have early histories of abuse and or neglect starting before age 7. When people quote this paper, they never include starting before age 7. Why is that? Because the brain grows different systems at different ages, and there are certain systems that change in response to particular things that happen at a particular stage of brain development. So the age is very important, as Marty Teicher's work is showing again. And so we then put 137 people at the Cambridge Hospital together, compare our trauma data with everything else. And what gets me very interested is something that, of course, you guys are interested in, is not the issue of diagnosis, but the issue of certain behaviors. I've always been very curious why some people at the end of a rough day take a cigarette in the and stub it out on their arm and feel better afterwards. Why do some people starve themselves and feel better afterwards? Why do some people say, like one of my patients, once a Hollywood actress once said to me, what eating is for me is what vomiting is for other people. No, what an orgasm is for me, other people, vomiting is for me. And eating for me is like my greatest consolation. It's like an orgasm for me. How do people get to have their brain rewired to interpret things that for most of us are horrid and disgusting as being pleasurable and soothing? And that's something that I've been intrigued with a long time. And so we did a study on self-injurious behaviors. And what we saw is that the great predictor of self-injurious behaviors was childhood sexual abuse, self-physical abuse, to some degree neglect, binging wasn't all that clear, but again, anorexia highly related to childhood sexual abuse. But that was just the beginning, because all of these people were at Cambridge Hospital, which then, as now, is a very good psychotherapy hospital. It's where Harvard residents go to train in psychotherapy. And so we were curious who got better and who did not get better with psychotherapy. This is relevant to the work you do. What predicted that people wouldn't give up these behaviors was not childhood trauma, but childhood neglect. The lack of a consistent, safe caregiver predicted ongoing self-soothing behaviors. Now, I'd like to go back to invite you to think about the time that your heart was broken or your gut was wrenched. That is an experience that is well nigh unbearable. And every adult who I know who lives with profound heartache or gut wrench goes to their local psychopharmacologist or their local drug dealer or their local bar to do something to make those feelings go away. When you're a child, like the movie I just showed you, you have no choice to go to your drug dealer or to your psychopharmacologist. The only person who can make you calm you down is your caregivers. If your caregivers respond to you, and we all know this from experience, hopefully, your physiology calms itself down. So we calm our physiology down by mutual regulatory systems with voices and faces. If you run into harsh faces, if you are freaked out and upset, let's say somebody is beating you. Let's say your dad. Happens more often by moms, but we like to blame guys. Let's say your mom is beating you. And you look extremely distressed, and everything about your face says, I'm hurting, please don't do this to me. And they keep hitting you. You have no recourse, and your body is filled with heartache and gut wrench. And then you need to develop systems in your mind and brain to shut down that heartache and gut wrench. And that is what you guys are dealing with. You're dealing with people who have learned to starve themselves in order not to feel things, or to cut themselves, or to take drugs. But so what the research shows, and I can't give you all the data for this, but they're all spelled out in the book, is that most of the behaviors that we are supposed to abolish and make go away are in fact adaptations to help people survive. And as you know, when you work with eating disorders people, they will say, the real problem is not the anorexia. The real problem is what that anorexia does for me, how it helps me to survive and live with unbearable feelings, which makes our whole world quite complicated. And then, so let me say a little bit about the brain in a very superficial way. We now have 25 years of neuroscience behind us, and I happen to be part of the first team that took pictures of the brain when people remember their trauma. And somehow the messages from neuroscience have not really percolated into the clinical field. So this is our brain. And when you introduce yourself to me and say, hi, my name is Jennifer, I think to myself, wow, that's a really very nice, that little sliver over here at the front of her brain is Jennifer. Jennifer has opinions about things. She can tell me stories. She tells me where she has been, what she likes and what she doesn't like, and she can make plans for the future. The rest of her is determined by the rest of her brain, over which she has no control. Whether she becomes sleepy right now is not up to her. It's up to a part of the brain or up to me. If I give you a boring talk, I can probably put most of you asleep. Whether you get hungry or not is not up to this part of your brain. You either get hungry or you don't get hungry. But I don't know anybody who can make themselves not hungry. If I did, I would be a thinner man. And many of you would be also. You cannot, this part of your brain cannot tell you, don't be horny. Don't be attracted to this person. Shut down your sexuality. All of these things automatically happen in that very large part of our brain. And the problem also is that whole legacy of trauma and neglect sits in that nether region of the brain. And so the great challenge for all of us, and that's why I wrote this book, is how do you get in that nether region of your, of the region of the brain that doesn't depend on language and understanding. Language and understanding have a function because it, now you understand why you're doing things. But understanding why you do things doesn't change the way you feel. It just happens to make you understand why certain people piss you off, why you attracted some other people, and it gives you a rationale. It doesn't change your attractions, it doesn't change your repulsions, but it gives you a certain amount of control to begin to shape your life more consciously than not. But the nether part of your brain has no language, it has no understanding, and it, all, its job is to make sure that you're okay given the circumstances that you live under. And of course, what happens when you get traumatized is that part of the brain continues to live as if you're back there, as if you're in danger. And the language of that part of the brain is stress hormones, movement, electrical activity, actions. But that part of the brain, consciousness is different. So we have these two parts of the brain. And so the big challenge is, how do you get this part of the brain to be in charge, and or how do you make that part of your brain quiet? So you start off, the old model of the brain by now, 40 years old, is that we have three parts of our brain. This part of the brain that we come into the world with, our reptilian brain, it does what little babies do. They eat, they sleep, they suck, they breathe, they poo, they pee, that's about it. So that's a part of the brain that we like to sort of forget about as soon as possible. But unfortunately, that's where trauma hits. That's where neglect hits. That's where trauma lives. It lives in that reptilian part of your brain that makes you starve yourself, that makes you unable to sleep, that makes you have panic reactions in response to irrational things. And people can say, compare your irrational beliefs with reality, and it never works. So the first order of business, if you want to treat that reptilian brain, is to work with the reptilian brain. I didn't know anything about working with the reptilian brain until I started to go to a yoga studio. And somehow those guys in yoga studios had figured out how to deal with the reptilian brain way back in India. And then we did a whole bunch of research that showed that actually yoga is more effective for any trauma-related condition than any medication that I or anybody else had ever studied. That learning to breathe and to feel your body and feel every aspect of your body opens up pathways into your reptilian brain. And to my mind, that should be sort of a foundation of any treatment to help people to begin to own their bodies. And in order to own your body, you need to work with the body. You can work with the prefrontal cortex if that's what you prefer, but I don't think people get better and own your body if you just work with the prefrontal sliver. Second part of your brain is the limbic system. And the limbic system makes this map of the world. So if you see John's grandchild, a much adored grandchild, that kid all needs to do is come into a room and everybody goes, "Oh, wow, what a cutie. Oh, my God, how sweet." I saw you guys' faces light up when John showed his grandchild. That grandchild will not go until she's a self-conscious teenager like, "Hey, there's nothing special about me. I'm just one out of 8 billion children in the world and probably somewhere in the middle of the bell-shaped curve." Now, if you're a little kid who is being adored and people say you're the greatest, you actually think you're the greatest. And that memory of yourself being the greatest stays with you. It gets hardwired in that map of your brain. And you say, "I'm the greatest." And people always laugh, and they come into a room, and they smile, and they give me gifts. I'm the sort of person who just lights up a room. And later on, people dump you, and your friends die, and you don't get into the college you wanted to get into, get very disappointed. But deep down, that map of the world is, "I'm an adorable person." To hell with them. The opposite is also true. If your mom has become an alcoholic, drug addict, your dad is off in jail, and you see nothing but violence in the family, every kid is the center of their universe, and they say, "I am a terrible person. because I make terrible things happen. Because kids, as you know from child development, will have a causal relationship with the world around them and will say, I made my mom a drug addict, I made my people cry, and you get a concept of yourself as basically a defective person and damaged goods. My hunch is that most people you work with have that basic map of the world. And so what do most of us do when we're young and innocent? When people say that, you say, but you know, you're a wonderful person. Look, you're good at that, you're great at that, you're wonderful. And then start talking about their incest, and you say, oh, I was incested because I was loved my daddy too much, or whatever thing they come up with. And as a young therapist, you say, but you know, it wasn't your fault. It was your dad's fault. It was his job. Your job was to love your daddy, and his job was to keep the boundaries. And I used to do it with my patients all the time, until one day I said to a patient in a group, and she says, you know, Bessel, I have to say something, because you now have told me about 15 times in front of the whole group that it wasn't my fault, and pointed out all my virtues. But you know, I have to tell you, whenever you make these stupid statements, they're for you and not for me. They're to make you feel better because you feel so helpless because I feel so damaged and you don't have a clue about what to do about it. She says, you know, and whenever you make these comments to me, I say, thank you very much. You know why I say that? I'm an incest victim. I was trained to take care of narcissistically vulnerable men like you. I know it's very important for you to feel like I'm like you're a very good therapist. But I have to tell you, now that I know you for 2 years, it makes me feel terrible. It makes me feel lonely. It makes me feel like nobody gets it. And so then the question becomes, so aside from making stupid comments that don't get into that part of the brain, how can you reset that wiring of the brain so that people actually feel good about themselves? I'll give you two examples how, of the many things that we sort of have explored, discovered, worked with. One of them is EMDR. EMDR is a wonderful treatment to remember and process particular memories. And one of a person in my group who runs a group home for sexually abused girls who carries the diagnosis of borderline personality disorder, and of course, who had been sexually abused herself as a kid also, because that makes you want to run a group home for sexually abused girls, sits in the group, and she says, I had an amazing experience this weekend. I went to an EMDR training, and I had learned about EMDR, these weird people who wiggle their fingers in front of people's eyes. So I roll my eyes and say, oh my God, another cult follower. And she says, can I talk about it? And I said, well, not to me, but if the group wants to hear, it's fine by me. And of course, the group all wants to hear about it. And so she tells how during the EMDR, she saw herself being abused as a 7-year-old kid. And she says, you know, here I was this little 7-year-old little creature, this tiny little kid. And there was this huge guy lying on top of me, ramming stuff into me. It's disgusting. He smelled of alcohol. He was a big whale of a guy. How can a fucking bastard like do that to that little girl? So what the EMDR made it possible for her, and all good treatments do that, are able to separate yourself now from yourself then. As long as you confuse yourself right now as the person who was abused, you really cannot do the work. You need to develop a pilot in your brain. If I have time, I'll tell you what that pilot looks like, an ability to observe yourself and to say, right now I'm sitting in a chair here, and back then when I was 7 years old, that happened to that little kid. And then you ask, how do you feel about that kid back then? And most of the time people will say, I hate that kid. I can't stand that little frightened, compliant kid who didn't stand up for herself, who didn't fight for herself. She deserved everything she got. And until you get into the self-judging and self-observing things, you really don't get anywhere. And now she has EMDR IFS, hypnosis, a whole bunch of different things make it possible for people to observe themselves back there from the position of current security. And they can say, oh my God, look what happened to the little kid back then. It's not me. I was very little. I knew very little. It's not me right now. That's the problem in traumatic stress is that you think you are that person. But the past essentially is irrelevant. It doesn't matter what happened to you in the past. Because today we're in Bentley College, and it's the end of fall. It's beautiful out there. And you guys are really paying attention to what I'm saying. Today is today. It's only when all the imprints of the past continue to live in your body right now, not back then, but right now, that you are not able to be completely present right now. So the challenge is to help people to be fully alive right now, at this moment, and to see what happened back there, and to form a relationship with that wounded child and say, that's not me anymore. I still feel a little bit like that when people touch me in a particular way or people look at me in a particular way, but I'm now a grown-up person. And so your mind needs to be able to make the distinction, and I hope to have some time to point out what particular brain areas are involved in that. Okay, so that's that. So here's an example, a study by Seth Pollack, who will be at this year's trauma conference. He shows a series of pictures like this, a little morphing picture of a very sad woman, a very angry woman, and he shows these pictures one after another to a bunch of eight-year-olds. The eight-year-olds have not been abused. Somewhere around here, this eight-year-old will say, huh, she's not so sad anymore. She's beginning to look angry. But if you show the same series of pictures to an abused kid, somewhere over here, the abused kid will start picking up that this person is getting dangerous. So these are subliminal ways in which your threat detection system in the brain picks up stimuli that for the rest of us are perfectly all right, but for them, don't get filtered out as dangerous stimuli. This has certain implications. This is like why I do neurofeedback. So I do to help people to rewire their brains and to change these things around. Because the brain is basically, that's the big thing that I hope to talk about, is that what happens, the findings in neuroscience about all these so-called disorders in DSM, by and large, we have a brain in order to connect with people. We have a brain to interact with people. Almost every abnormality in the brain that has been found in various psychiatric disorders can be understood as being the result of not having been in gear, in sync, in conjunction with other people. And so all psychiatric disorders are basically functions of disconnection. Now, I don't know what Amy Banks told you this morning. She says connections are terribly important. Connections are terribly important, but if your connection system is messed up, then you're in trouble. And let me show you how messed up the connection system is. So I have these colleagues, former students of mine, Paul Fruin and Ruth Lanius, who import a $35,000 mannequin from Germany, a dark, handsome stranger. And when you lie in the scanner, the stranger comes by, looks at you, smiles, and goes on. And they take pictures of people's brains as this beautiful, dark-haired stranger comes by. And when a so-called normal person, I call everybody so-called normal because I really have never met a normal person in my life. When a normal person sees a dark, handsome stranger like that, their frontal lobe lights up like crazy. And you're thinking, boy, I wonder if he likes the dress that I'm wearing. I wonder if he also likes the Rolling Stones. I wonder if he would like my cooking. I wonder if he likes the color of my bed sheets and stuff like that. So we see when we see a dark, handsome stranger, we start fantasizing about all the wonderful things that we can do with a dark, handsome stranger, and nothing needs to happen, but that encounter can make your day, as long as you have a good fantasy life. Then they put a group of 18 people in the scanner who have histories of severe abuse and neglect as children. They show the same handsome stranger going by, and what lights up is not their frontal lobe, not their imagination, not all the wonderful things they can do together, but an area of the brain called the periaqueductal gray. Has anybody ever had cockroaches in their apartment here? Only a few of us? I hate to tell you what cockroaches look like when you come into the kitchen at night. When you come in the kitchen, you turn on the light, they scurry. They're frightened by light. This is the cockroach part of your brain. That's the part of your brain that's sort of the ultimate terror part of your brain. And so this very nice looking handsome stranger sets up activation of the terror center of the brain. That's how some of our patients see us. Good luck to you. Chasing their brain. And having people who are fundamentally terrified about what people do for them say, I have, everybody else up to now has messed with me, but I believe that you are going to treat me okay. You're going to be an exception. But my whole brain is wired to react to the world like everybody's going to mess with me, and I have to take care of all the stirrings in my body by starving myself or cutting myself and stuff like that. People do this stuff in order to not have to depend on the horrible stuff that strangers are likely to do to them. These are tough issues. It's a bit of an old slide. I should have put in some pictures of last night's primaries. But basically, when you meet somebody, you need to assess whether somebody is safe or dangerous. The areas of your brain that do that is the insula, the amygdala, superior temporal gyrus, and the fusiform gyrus, little parts of your brain that help you to assess whether you can trust somebody. Every one of these areas of the brain gets damaged by early childhood trauma and neglect. So our patients have a very hard time detecting who is safe and who is dangerous. And we oftentimes are horrified by their judgment. They go off with very dangerous people and don't see how dangerous they are. And they are terrified of safe people, because it doesn't work. And you can point out to people, hey, this is a really dangerous guy. But if you don't feel it in your gut, because these things have changed, there's not much you can do. So again, back to the attachment thing. So we're basically, we're wired, quarter to five, right? Have now half hour, good. So we're wired for interactions. So our basic nature is to imitate each other, to be just like each other, to follow each other's movements and actions. Again, this is a part that, thanks to the legacy of Sigmund Freud and drugs, we really don't celebrate in the treatments that we do. But when you start learning about child development, we know that we're basically rhythmical, synchronous creatures. And in order to get a sync with other people, you have to activate the synchronous pathways. Let me just show you something. I've never shown this one before, but it's nice. The people who understand this, how terribly important it is to get in sync with each other.
Mama roll over, this is what she said.
Mama roll over, this is what she said.
I'll give me some.
I'll give me some.
I'll give me some.
I'll give me some.
P.T.
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 Good for you.
Good for you.
Good for me.
Good for me.
Boom good.
Boom good.
Up in the morning to the rising sun.
Up in the morning to the rising sun.
Got the blue balls, crabs, and the 7-year itch.
Love these guys. That's how you train US Marines. Why do I show that? These kids are terrified. They're fundamentally no good. They come from deprived backgrounds. They didn't finish high school. They couldn't do anything else. And these guys understood what you do with very frightened people who don't have a sense of purpose and direction. You get them to move together and to sing together in synchrony. And when basic training is over after 12 weeks, they feel powerful. They feel capable. They feel competent. They can think. There is something about moving together, singing together, getting in sync with other people. That's a very powerful way of organizing your brain. In fact, that's what we have brains for. The purpose of our brains is to get in sync with each other. But we don't use this as treatment models. How basic this is illustrated by this. This is Andy Posner, but Andy, University of Seattle. This is a 5-hour-old baby. He sticks out his tongue, the baby shakes out his tongue. He opens his mouth, baby opens his mouth. We're completely co-wired systems. That's the only people we are. We don't exist independently from each other. So that's what we have brains for. And that's how every part of our brain grows in the context of the synchronous relationship to us and the people around us. That gives us mental structures, it gives us brain structures, it gives us wiring, gives us chronic responses. And when it goes wrong, a lot of different parts of the brain go offline. Let me see what's... I have a beautiful movie of a kid. Do any of you know that maybe? It's a movie by John Robertson and John Bowlby called John. A kid goes to the hospital is one of them, about what happens to kids who are separated from their parents and how they stop eating, they stop moving, and they stop being able to relate to other people. When your caregiver goes and the trusted people in your life go, that whole internal system starts disintegrating and falls apart. I won't take your time with it because we have other things to do. So this is a very important part, and this shows up a lot in our work with eating disorders patients, because we do many different sort of brain stuff with those patients. It's something called the default state of the brain. That's what happens in the brain when you just are sitting in front of a traffic light and not listening to the radio, ready for the light to change, when you sit here bored to tears with what I'm talking about, and you just sort of wait, okay, another half hour of this, and you sort of let your brain idle, sort of quietly let it go. So that's your brain spending time with itself, not paying anything, any attention to each other. And those core brain structures are located over here in the middle part of your brain. Did Amy talk about it? The midline structures of the brain, the mohawk of the brain. So the structures of the brain related to you and your relationship to yourself are located in what the old yogis called the third eye. That's when you're thinking about yourself. And you have an area here in the back of your brain called the posterior cingulate that allows you to know, oh, I'm sitting in this hall in Bentley College in Waltham, and if I want to go home back to Somerville, I need to go somewhere else. But again, it's one of these maps of the world. This is where I am, and when you know where you are, you know where you're going. Okay? So my colleagues put 16 normal Canadians in the scanner. It's a lot of normal Canadians, easy to come by, and they're just lying in a scanner, and you get this default mode of the brain. And what lights up is area of the brain right here, this who I am, this what I like, this what I stand for. No, I don't like the Patriots, but I'd rather see that movie about something else, and we have to negotiate to see what we both like, and then we both get excited and our frontal lobes light up and we get this imaginary sense of pleasure as we think about what we're going to do. Back of the brain, this where I am. It's late in the day, I wish I had a glass of wine right now, I wish the chairs weren't so hard, I wish we could go up and move. This my body is, a very big part of your brain is devoted to your housekeeping of your body. So these are normal Canadians. Then she puts 18 chronically traumatized people, probably worse than most people who you treat in your practice, in the scanner, and this is what happens to their brain. That is the appropriate sound, that person who just moaned. This is one of the worst things I've ever seen in a brain scan. And to my mind, we should all have this in our offices, because this is what we're up against. If you have a chronic history of trauma, there's a whole part of the brain that you expect to be able to say, this is not good for me. This is good for me. I like food. I like spaghetti. I don't like sausages, but I love shrimp. I like to go to the ball game. I like to go to movies. This is who I am. That's what I stand for. Gone. The back of the brain, body self-experience, largely gone. This is our problem. This is the core problem in the people we work with, and because we're scanning a different form of scanning right now called S-Loretta, sort of more EEG brain waves-based studies, where we see that large part of the brain having to do with you, what you want and what's good for you, is not there. So the big challenge is, how do you get a sense of you online? I am here. And maybe I showed you that little clip for the first time, I'd never shown this in public before, of the US Marine Corps, because I think these guys are up to something, onto something. Feeling your body. Let me tell you another story. I was a consultant to the Truth Commission in South Africa. And it was an amazing process, most interesting thing I've done in my life. Didn't do anything myself, but I got to see it. And in the context of that, I got to have a conversation with Nelson Mandela. And you know, I said, you know, before you were put in jail for 27 years, people say that you were the head of the terrorist army. You know, I'm in sympathy with you, but they were blowing up places and killing people. They were terrorists. And then you go in solitary confinement for 27 years, and you come out like a damn saint. How do you account for this amazing transformation that you went through? He says, boxing. I go, boxing. He says, yeah. You know, when you box, you really need to know where your body is. You need to see where another person's body is. You need to read this other person's intention. You need to imagine that if you plant a hook over there, what the other person will do. So you get into this very complex mental game very fast about what feels good to you, what feels bad to you, what feels good to the other person, all this interactive stuff. And I go like, wow, that's exactly what we find on our brain scans goes wrong with chronically traumatized people. That whole part of the brain has to do with me. This is what's important to me. These are the consequences of my actions. I stand for myself. I won't let you hit me. All wiped out. Maybe boxing might be a great treatment for anorexia nervosa. Good luck getting funding for that study. My ultimate study, I have many studies in my mind, but the ultimate study I'd love to do is tango dancing versus cognitive behavioral treatment. Tango dancing is the perfect trauma treatment. In fact, it was invented by prostitutes and sailors in Buenos Aires, the end of the world, very traumatized people, and they discovered that by moving together in sync and being very close attention to where your body and how your body is moving with somebody else, that makes them feel calm, safe, and competent. Maybe tango dancing might be the best treatment you guys can do. So I'm telling you all this stuff just to begin to open your mind, like, maybe it's not so crazy. Maybe we should make this into an evidence-based treatment rather than giving evidence-based treatments that don't seem to work. So this is, for example, what we do in our clinic. We see a lot of people, we're a clinic, we're a Medicaid clinic, so we see a lot of very poor people, very traumatized people, and we also have a little private branch where we can do more things and some more money available to do things. We see a lot of adoptees, and we see, because we live in Brookline, a lot of gay people who adopt kids from Eastern Europe and China. They could be the same people as single mothers who live in housing projects, but this happens to be people who can pay for it, which I have some feelings about, but that's the reality. And so we get these very messed up adoptees and with very devoted parents. And about 10 years ago, we got a 4.5-year-old Chinese girl referred to us, who after 3 years of having been adopted by these very nice people, wasn't talking, was cutting herself, was injuring herself, and was nonverbal. And so we tried to pull anything out, everything out, nothing works. And then one of our clinicians has this smart idea to send her to OTA in Watertown, to occupational therapy people who do sensory integration. And when you do sensory integration, you walk on balance beams, you sit on swings, you lie on under heavy blankets, and you activate a system of the brain that regular people never paid attention to, but it's terribly important, is a vestibular cerebellar system. The system in your brain that helps you to feel where you are and what your body is doing. That system gets very disturbed if you don't get touched, held, and responded to in a synchronous way. But because we don't think that way, we always think about frontal lobe stuff. And so this girl goes to OTA, sits on swings, lies under heavy blankets, and she starts talking after about 4 months. And so the basic issue here is that if you calm that back of your brain down, if you calm that down the foundation of your brain, and you learn to breathe and to move and to feel your body, slowly the attic, your frontal lobe, will start coming online. But as long as your attic is flooded, your basement is flooded, your attic ain't gonna work. And so you always need to start in the basement. And so we set up our own sensory integration clinic run by Liz Warner. And a funny thing happens, maybe you want to try this out also, is we discovered that when these very traumatized, out of control kids start jumping on trampolines, they get quieter, more thoughtful. And we see a thing that really amazes us because we videotape all that stuff and analyzing the videotapes. And what we see is that these kids are really totally freaked out in the moment. When they start jumping up and down, they start talking about yesterday and tomorrow. The issue of yesterday and tomorrow is a critical brain function. If you're trapped in the horrible feelings of the present, you cannot plan for the future. So you can only learn from the past and project to the future if a certain part of your brain that can connect past and future together, that part of the brain is called the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, which we know is damaged by early childhood trauma. And so we find that when these kids start jumping, activated vestibular cerebellar system, they start talking about yesterday and tomorrow. So something in their frontal lobe starts changing.
Are you happy?
I can't wait to see the face of my father's face.
So
we have little trampolines in all of our offices. And then I'm into attachment, into attunement, into brains getting formed by attuned interactions. And I see this sort of looming corner coming out of the corner, and I think that movement is not in sync with whatever is going on in the room. So I get a little alarmed by what I see here.
The PSP.
What's the PSP?
It's a hair PlayStation
2
system game.
Uh-huh, so you
want to
make your dad happy too. Making your mom laugh out there, making your dad happy.
He's goofy.
Huh?
I say he's goofy.
A disconnect. She's saying something that's completely out of sync with whatever else is going on. So there's, everybody's in their own little motoric and mental world. That to me is what it's all about. Everything else is secondary.
Goofy? Yeah. I know stuff. He's good at getting you laughing sometimes. That's a good thing, huh?
Yeah, because I have a weakness bugging all.
How many people were upset by what you just saw? One. Interesting. Sorry, that's disturbing to me, actually. Because what just happened is the diagnosis. The diagnosis is in this constellation, there's only room for one person to talk at a time. So the mom doesn't synchronize her talking with the kid. She starts talking, I had a rough day too. Kid falls on the floor and says, there's no room for me here. That's the diagnosis. And when you start seeing that, you start making real diagnoses.
Yeah,
Robbie.
I know all the craziness. Just today too.
Today too?
Yeah, really bad. Down in the wild. I know why.
Right now, my feet are so
heavy. I feel like I'm evil.
Not feeling great, huh?
No, so.
I need a new phone!
So you're happy to have a new phone. And what
is
that?
He's just trying so hard.
Is that the house that came through the mail?
Just now, today.
Oh.
Catch!
I decided to get that SafeLink phone. How many
people are upset about that? Good. Numbers are increasing. Good.
They've been having it on TV. It's through the government. They put like $84 a month on it, and it's a free phone for emergencies.
I'd rather
for him to have that, you know, because now he's going to be going into the sixth grade, you know, and he needs it. I want him to start learning the phone and everything, and then I really think he needs to.
Stop throwing it over there.
A lot of times he.
Not really the sort of tennis partner you really are looking for, right?
Leaves his
key.
His key.
Mm-hmm. My key. Thank God.
And so I should have cut this and made it very clear. So then Liz plays with them for about 50 minutes until they get in sync with each other. And finally, something starts to happen.
Snake eyes. No snake. Snake eyes.
That was the first meaningful sound I heard. You hear what she said? Good. The sound of pleasure. Look in any psychiatric textbook or textbook on eating disorders and look in the index if it has the word pleasure. If it doesn't, don't buy it. As if life is irrelevant to pleasure. When you're together with other people, you're supposed to have fun together. Even if you write a grant together or you work with a difficult patient, it's supposed to be interesting. It's supposed to be fascinating. It's supposed to engage you. And if it doesn't, there's something wrong. So, whenever people get in sync, the next thing is laughter. A patient of mine calls me last week, horrible trauma history, and she's just totally freaked out. And she's in Washington. I say, just run down the mall, when you get to the park bench in front of the Smithsonian, stand on top of the park bench and sing the Hallelujah chorus. She knows that I'm weird, so she said. So, and call me up after you finish her little course. So she runs down the mall, gets a sense of rhythm, to my mind more the rhythm than the BDNF, the feeling in your body that I have a body that's running. And then she makes a sound. And she calls me up and says, hey, it worked. Doesn't need to be a Hallelujah chorus. Now, I say, don't write it, you know, sing the Hallelujah chorus. You know, like that would be missing the boat. That's about getting and singing something, particularly in unison. John Wayne and I go sing in the Hallelujah chorus in Christmas if you're both in town. I don't want to say bad things about my friend, but he is not really the most gifted singer I've ever met. But boy, are we having fun, aren't we? It is so much fun to sing in sync with other people. And it almost doesn't matter unless there's too many people looking mad at you. But we don't sing in our culture. So the issue, an issue I think we should address. So how do you overcome trauma? You overcome trauma by having experiences that are fundamentally different from the experiences that you've had. But profoundly so, not thinking about or you should or something. No, you need to have them. And so you need to take action. Action that restores these pathways that the U.S. Marine Corps so beautifully activates by doing things. So there's a piece from Joe Ledoux who shows that if threat comes into the brain and goes into the pathway that activates the muscles, you activate a sense of power, efficacy, and self-realization. If you sit still, if you're held down, if you're on restrictions and you're not allowed to go out and move, then this impulse goes to the central nucleus of the amygdala, and you experience the same stress hormones get secreted, but instead of a stress hormones that mobilize you to do stuff and to feel effective, they go into another part of your brain called the central nucleus, the amygdala, and it makes you feel panicked and helpless. So if you are passive in response to stuff, and you don't speak up, and you don't stand up for yourself, you get these panic reactions. So who figures out how to do with that? Rarely psychologists and almost never psychiatrists. Who are the people who have the model program? A bunch of karate teachers in Oakland figure it out. A fifth degree black belt karate woman in Oakland is raped. And her colleagues say, how is it possible that anybody who could basically kill anybody with their bare hands could get raped? And they're thoughtful karate teachers, and they say, she must have become de-skilled. I bet most people in this room have been de-skilled. You know something really well, you get nervous, and suddenly you sound like a blubbering idiot, and you forget all the moves. And we don't know if she got freaked out because she had a prior history of trauma. We don't know that. But anyway, she was raped. And so her colleagues say, so let's set up a program where we teach women to be mindful and to really look. Because usually when you have an attacker, as long as you keep a clear mind, as long as you activate your medial prefrontal cortex, that pilot part of your brain that observes what's going on inside, goes on. You can sort of observe what's going on, and you can usually plan what you want to do. But when you get really scared, that pilot gets wiped out, and you start falling apart, and then anybody can take advantage of you. So they said, let's start a mindfulness program where we train women to stay mindful even though they get threatened. And then we teach them karate, and we get them procedural memory so that they are accustomed to poking people's eyes out, kicking them in the groin, do all kinds of stuff to defend themselves, so it becomes an automatic action. And then we're going to do a graduation scene. So I'm going to play you the graduation scene of a patient of mine who, as a kid, was paddled by her dad to satisfy truckers' sexual needs at truck stops. And this is a graduation scene. This, to my mind, is what therapy is about. Giving people the courage to face tough things.
Comes around here. Nobody! You're going down.
So her brain used to be wired to if something happens, I'm helpless, I can't do anything, I collapse. So her brain is retrained to take action. So the whole middle part, limbic part of her brain is a helpless brain, like so many people we all work with. And so how do you make that helpless brain a brain that knows how to take action? You either join the U.S. Marine Corps or you join Impact Model Mugging. There's a program like that here in Somerville now. I'm on their board. And you rewire the brain in order to teach people that you can take action. And the proof of the pudding came to my patients 3 months later. She calls me up and says, I'm in the neighborhood. I'd like to just tell you the story in person. And she stops by and she says, a few nights ago, I was up in the Widener Library at Harvard, and just 12 o'clock, lights went out, and so time to go home. I put my books on my arm. I walked down Oxford Street in Cambridge and around Wendell Street, the corner of Wendell and Oxford. These three guys come from behind the bushes and say, "Bitch, give me your money." You know what I did? I went, "Okay, guys, I'm ready for you. I've been trained for this. Which one of you would like to take me on?" And she says, very disappointing, they ran away. I didn't get to come. I don't need any more outcome studies after that to know that this was effective. But it's by taking action. You have to do things that empower people. One of the ways that I got into this is about 10 years ago, I was trained in sitting down and talking, and I talk, and I'm a good therapist. And basically, I've worked this for 5 years or something. I'm away for the summer, starting to write on my book. I come back 2 months later, and this kick-ass woman walks into my office. And I go like, "What happened to you?" She said, "Nothing." "Well, you walk differently, you talk differently, your voice is different." I said, "Oh, maybe it has something to do. I've been taking kickboxing lessons twice a week." I say, "What's the name of your kickboxing lesson coach? Because I'd like to take lessons with her also," which I did. So learning how to kick ass, to feel the power in your body, to feel a physical sense of, I can do, I can defend myself, I can take care of myself viscerally, is critical. So that's one. So action is important. Second piece is accessing the emotional brain. So this is again a slide from the great neuroscientist Joseph Ledoux. And he sort of has the great amygdala person, that threat system in the back of the brain that has no language. People automatically become frightened. People automatically shut down. And so all of us are terribly interested. How can you get to own and be in control over that part of the brain? So he does all his studies in his laboratory, and he finds out that the rational understanding, figuring out part of the brain simply has no pathways to your emotional brain. If you ever wonder about it, just talk yourself out of being in love with somebody, or talk yourself out of being hungry. So that's the bad news. But then Luke comes up with a very important news, and it sort of fits in where John ended up his talk also. And that is that the way that a brain is built up, and all of us how many people have had babies here in the room? About half of you. For those of you who haven't had babies, have some babies. Very, very helpful to understand your patients and stuff, and what you can and cannot do. And like a few years ago, a woman comes to the trauma center and says, "I need some help because somebody needs to help to teach my baby not to be so selfish." I go, "Oh yeah." A little neuroscience education probably wouldn't quite do it. That's sort of a fundamental deficit there somewhere. So we made her more motherly. That's not the end of the story. But Ledoux points out, and there's now a huge area in neuroscience, a lot of grants in it, a lot of studies at Harvard actually, is that we have a middle part of our brain that's devoted to ourselves. So our brain is a social brain. I'm social with you. I'm just saying things to you guys that you'll find interesting. I may be lying hard part of the time, just like those guys last night were, but it doesn't matter. I want to get your vote. That's what talking is all about. It's a social brain, and the function of the social brain is not to tell the truth. That's not the function of the social brain. The social brain, function of the social brain is to get along with other people, to make other people like you. They got other people to bring you that Coke when you're thirsty, stuff like that, to convince other people for your point of view. It is just a symbolic piece, and you need to just find something in common with the other person. So that part of your brain is not a truth teller. It's to get along with others. But there is a part of your brain that is about you and your relationship to yourself. And that's this midline structures of the brain. It starts over here, orbital prefrontal, medial prefrontal cortex, anterior cingulate, insula, posterior cortex. It's the midline structures of the brain are about your relationship to yourself. Eating disorders are about your relationship to yourself. Cutting and burning yourself is about your relationship to yourself. It's very nice when people tell you stories, why they do it, how they got to do it, etc. All very enlightening, won't make any difference. The only way to do it is to access the medial prefrontal cortex. That's the only way you can change your animal brain, your survival brain. And so John was a little cavalier about meditation. I'm very on the cavalier about meditation, because the only way you can ever change anything about yourself is by meeting yourself. But the bad news, of course, is I showed you an earlier scan where we looked at that part of the brain and there was nothing there. And that's what I find in the eating disorders programs that I get involved with, where you ask people, who are you? What do you stand for? What do you want to do with your life? You can't find the people who underneath it. And so this is your immense challenge that you have, is how do you get somebody to be there? Somebody who has desires, who has body sensations, who feels their butt on the floor, who feels their fist against some pillow or something, and says, this is my body. I feel it now. I experience it now. You cannot own your body as long as you cannot know what's going on in your body. And so that is what we do for a living these days, is to grow this part of your brain. So what research shows, and I'm almost finished, is that the size of this part of your brain, that interoceptive, self-knowing part of your brain, decides how effective you are, how much you can make plans that are good for you, to what degree you let yourself get hijacked by irrelevant stuff and other people's opinion or a loud noise or irrelevant information. The larger this part of your brain is, the more you have a sense of, this is what's important for me. This is what I want to do. And in traumatized people, and in our eating disorder studies that we're doing, that part of the brain is pretty damn gone, or small, or barely there. And so the big question is, how do you grow that part of the brain? And good news is it can be done. The bad news, it's not so easy. And so the first people who studied this is Richie Davison, a neuroscience person at the University of Wisconsin. He goes to Tibet and studies Tibetan monks who have been tortured by the Chinese, but they're traumatized. And he measures that this part of their brain, he has to remember what it's like to have Chinese guys torture them. And they lie there, and instead of feeling all scared and frightened and reliving their trauma, they start reliving how they were lying there while somebody was cutting a testicle off, thinking, oh, that's really painful. I wonder what it's like for the guy who's doing the cutting right now to be cutting my testicle off right now. Most people in this room, not only because you're women, would not think about what the experience is like for you to be cutting somebody else's body parts off. That's a degree of mindfulness and observation of both yourself and of other people that only comes after years and years of self-observation and growing that part of your brain to be huge. I doubt whether anybody in this room will ever get to that stage of life. But what's very clear from the research that's happening, and there's more and more happening, is the more you grow that part of your brain, the more you pay attention to that inner world, and to depart slightly from John here, you need to really pay attention to yourself, your internal experience. You need to feel yourself. So the first person in our neighborhood who gets into that is John Kabat-Zinn, who starts this beautiful mind-body program at the University of Massachusetts in Worcester. And I sent my patients to his program, about the first five. They all flunk out, because sitting still in a room is a terrifying experience. Because Trauma is not something that happened in the past, because that's over. Trauma lives inside of you. And once you become still, the demon starts spooking around. And you sit there in silence, and you start having flashbacks and nightmares and chest pains and horrible sensations in your body. Sensations related to the trauma. Most traumatized people cannot do meditation. You can start it. I know if any of you have tried the meditation program in your clinic, I'd be very curious how well it goes. But I doubt whether it's very useful because it's too much. The silence is too much. But the yoga program, you still go inside of yourself and you touch your toe. And you feel what it feels like to stand on one leg. And so you pay attention to your body in a very concentrated way. Qigong, same thing. So Qigong, yoga, jiu-jitsu, taiko drumming, probably all very powerful methods to grow this part of the brain that is essential for people to develop a guardian of themselves. So they can say, I'm hungry. I'm not hungry. I would like to have a hamburger. Instead of having other people say today, you need to have a hamburger. And you say, but I don't feel anything. The desire at the end needs to come from lust inside of yourself. And to have that, you need to have an insula. An insula is part of your brain that connects you with your body. In all of our neuroimaging studies, I threw these out. This is my last sentences. We find a highly damaged insula. So when you get traumatized, neglected, ignored, you suppress those feelings about your body. We did a yoga study. We did some neuroimaging before and after. And after people do yoga, that insula that tells you what your body is feeling and what your body needs starts coming online gradually. And I'm not saying that yoga is the answer. In fact, I'm not saying that anything that they talk about is the answer, because we are way too early to know that. One of the worst things that happened in our field was the so-called evidence-based treatments. I was part of the damn thing. And suddenly somebody in 1995 says, I have found the best evidence-based treatment for PTSD. And I go, really? I mean, you compared your particular protocol with doing nothing, and you got a 10% improvement, and that means that you have found the answer to mankind's ills. And so by jumping into these so-called evidence-based treatments, people thought that they had the answer. And as all of you in this room know, none of these things work all that well. And let's face it, a 10% improvement is not good enough. We need to actually get an 80% improvement. And with the current treatments that people do, you cannot get there. And you cannot get there until you understand the brain and the damage that the brain causes to developing human beings in the people you work with. And you need to activate the circuits that are damaged in order to get people to be full ownership of their bodies. Good luck to you with that.
Thank you.
Any questions, or is it all clear and it's all clear. See you later. Bye.